This show is proudly brought to you by the Hashtag Me Network.
And now, Hashtag Radio NZ.
Welcome to Hashtag Radio. I'm Phid McAwesome.
And I'm V8 Maddie.
And on this week's uncultured roundup of social media, web, tech and gaming, we have the two big boys in the gaming industry on the show.
Red versus blue.
Red versus blue? Green versus
green blue. Versus blue.
Yeah, green versus blue.
Oh, geez, I was thinking of cars.
Yeah. we were lucky enough to actually get both Xbox New Zealand, the boss, and the boss of PlayStation New Zealand.
Yeah.
Both on the show, on the same show.
On the same show, so it's going to be a death match.
It is. They're going to be talking to us about their experience at E3. Like last week we talked about what we thought of E3. They're going to give us what they thought of E3.
E3 sounds phenomenal. I'd love to get along at some stage.
It's on our list of things to do as part of Hashtag.
It's on the bucket list, I guess we'll say.
This week we do not have news.
No news, because news is done by the always glamorous Charis McAwesome.
Yeah.
And she's not with us today. She'd heard about a World Cup to do with Brazilians.
Yeah, she's at the Brazilian World Cup.
She is. She doesn't know anything about football, but what she doesn't know about a Brazilian isn't worth knowing.
Well, the funny thing is, the Brazilian World Cup isn't actually held in Brazil.
No.
No, it is held in East Hamilton.
Hamilton East?
Yeah. And we're not sure if she's a judge or if she's participating.
No, I don't know. But I'm sure that we'll get a good roundup of all the Brazilian news next week.
Yeah, so she'll be back next week. But we do have some tech news this week.
A little bit of tech news. There's on the big long list of smartphones, there's a new player.
Again.
Enters the ring.
Yeah.
We've got the...
Here comes a new challenger.
The details for the Amazon Fire Phone.
Amazon or Amazon?
Did I say Amazon?
You said Amazon.
I was thinking phone and Amazon at the same time. They should have called it the Amazon.
The Amazon would have sounded better than the Fire Phone.
I've outdone their marketing guys already.
Yeah.
The Amazon Fire Phone.
Yeah.
So the Amazon Fire Phone is due for launch 25th of July in the United States of America.
Yep.
Pricing, as you'd expect, will be cheaper if you get it on a dirty big contract.
That's a big contract, the one too. It's a 2-year contract to AT&T.
Yeah, which is a big contract considering it's the States.
Yeah.
And I mean, sounds pretty normal to us.
Yeah.
But for the States, that's a pretty hefty sign-up. You can purchase the phone outright in the States for $649 US.
So if that ever comes to New Zealand, we're looking at about half a mil?
About half a mil, yeah. Yeah. So we'll throw out a few specs for you. So it's got a 13-megapixel rear-facing camera.
It's not quite a 41-megapixel.
No, it's not quite 20.7 megapixels either.
Yeah.
4.7-inch screen. 2.2 gigahertz quad-core processor, 2 gig of RAM. It'll be running Amazon's custom Android, which they call Fire OS.
Another OS for us to contend with.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's just a version of Android. Gorilla Glass, front and back.
Yeah, so we were just talking about this off air. It's the second phone in the last couple of weeks to be released or announced. And released.
With glass.
With glass front and back. It's, Apple's old trick is being taken up by other people now.
Yeah, because Apple are renowned for being innovators.
Apparently so.
So we can expect to see a few more court cases. Gesture-based navigation. I know that was a big thing that you are keen to see, Phid.
I am, because that's the one feature on the BlackBerry. Rest in peace, BlackBerry, that I actually did like. I think out of all the smartphones I've tried in the last couple of years for reviews and stuff, BlackBerry did gestures the best.
Okay.
Yeah.
I used the BlackBerry briefly, so I didn't really get a good feel for the gestures.
Yeah.
I know my Xperia Z2 has the functions,
yeah,
but I think I've got it turned off. But yeah, maybe next week I'll come back with a bit of news on how the gestures work on that. See how that goes. They also have what they call dynamic perspective, which gives a 3D look to what you're looking at on the phone.
Yeah, what's been bugging me though is the media coverage of this phone. They've been calling it a 3D display, and it's not really 3D, is it?
No, it's not a 3D display. It's really just an image that moves when you move the screen. A lot like the wallpapers do on your iPhones and stuff now, where people were complaining about it because they were getting motion sickness.
Yeah. So it's the same technology, just done to a deeper level.
Yeah, much deeper level. They've actually got four cameras, one on each corner of the front of the phone.
And this confused us when we first saw it.
Well, it confused you.
Oh, it confused me. what was the point of having four cameras on the front of the phone?
Hang on. This phone says it's got five cameras. What's that about?
Yeah.
Well, the four on the front, one on each corner, are basically for giving you real-time
depth perception?
Depth, yeah, yeah. So it's tracking your head and the movement of your head so that it can make its dynamic perspective stuff work all magic-like.
So Samsung already does this with their phones, you know, the eye tracking and stuff like that.
Yep.
With their camera. So it's taking that to a whole different level.
Yeah, I think the Xperia does that sort of thing too.
Yeah.
Where it's it knows when you look away and that sort of thing. So it'll pause what you're watching and that sort of jazz.
Yeah. So, it's taking that technology to a deeper level.
It also has what they call Firefly.
Yeah, this one was an interesting feature, but purely a sales technique, I think.
Yeah, because it's Amazon, of course, they've had to build in something that'll work so that you can scan any product
and buy it from them.
And it'll show you where to buy it on their website.
Yeah.
So it'll pop it up on Amazon. It was funny, here you go, you can have that. Yeah,
on the ad it said it will show you where to buy it, but the only place it's going to show you where to buy it is Amazon.
I agree. They can say what they like. We know it's going to go straight to Amazon.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it looks like a pretty reasonable phone spec-wise.
Yeah.
A couple of nifty tricks. It didn't look too terrible either.
No, it's not a horrible-looking phone. It didn't look staggeringly, like, it wasn't saying that grabbed my attention, like, wow, it's an amazing looking phone.
No.
Like, I mean, like with the S series of Samsung phones when they started coming out, like with the S3 and stuff, the design was amazing compared to what I was used to with the iPhones.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
And now they're going back to a more iPhone-y kind of a look.
Yeah.
Even though it's bigger and it's got a better OS.
Yeah.
And it's not made by Apple.
Yeah. Yeah, I think there's some awesome features in this phone, but yet to see whether it's going to actually take off. I mean, especially outside of the States, the Amazon Fire Kindle, or Kindle Fire.
Kindle Fire, which was the e-reader, of course, for who weren't playing along.
The biggest thing that people disliked about that is the fact that Amazon completely locked it out from the Android market, so I assume they're going to do the same thing with this.
Yeah, well, I'm curious as to why they did their own custom Android OS. What's wrong with the standard Android OS?
Well, no one actually releases, like they said it's their own Android, no one actually releases their own Android, do they? I mean their original Android, sorry. Sony have their own take on Android, Samsung have their own take on it. No two Android phones are created equal.
But this one, having watched the stuff online, where they were showing it, scrolling through apps and stuff, it looks a lot different.
Yeah.
You've got your Sonys and your Samsungs and stuff, the Android looks fairly similar, and I guess people that are familiar with Android want to be able to just buy a phone and know how to work it.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, if I bought it, I'd want to be able to download stuff from the app, from Play, but I'm going to go out on a limb and assume that you're not going to have access to Play until someone releases a good hack for it.
I don't know. I guess we'll have to watch this space. But that's the Amazon Fire phone.
Yeah.
Or the Amazon.
The Amazon.
Of course, coming up, we've got Xbox and PlayStation 4.
Yeah.
The perspective from E3 from the big boys themselves.
Yeah. Also, later in the show, we've got a new podcast to talk about.
Yes.
And a few other things that we've got coming up in the pipeline.
Exactly. So, it's time for a song?
It is.
We'll be back right after this. You're on Hashtag. Welcome back to Hashtag Radio.
Anyway, like we said before the break, we are going to be chatting to Krister from PlayStation.
Krister from PlayStation.
And later on we'll be chatting to Steve from Xbox as well. But I think we'll just jump straight into it, eh? Have a chat.
Yeah.
Have a chat to Krister. On the line at the moment we have Krister from PlayStation New Zealand. How's it going?
Very well. How are you?
So... E3, you were over there?
Yes, I was. It was fantastic. It was a great time.
So what is the E3 experience like?
It's something pretty crazy. It really is like, you know, they throw terms around like it's Disneyland for gamers. There's just so much to take in, so many people. The money they put into creating these amazing stands dedicated to gaming is something else. You're just walking around. You walk around one corner, there's a full replica Batmobile. You walk around another corner, there's a 40-foot beast out of Evolves, you know, towering over the top of you. Around the other side, there's a replica section of old London town that's there for you to play, you know, the Order 1886 in there. So there's just so much to take in, but it's a whole lot of fun.
Oh, wow. So what excited you most about the big old Sony PlayStation announcement?
That's a tricky one. There was a lot of good content in there. A lot of content came out of our media conference. If I had to choose, I'm pretty big Little Big Planet fan, so I'm looking forward to playing the new characters in Little Big Planet 3. And to be honest, I'm hoping that's going to be played on my new Glacier White PS4. I'm hoping to score one of those as well, because I got to see that in the, you know, in the full flesh, and it looks really nice.
So you guys announced a whole heap of games. Would you be able to give us like a rundown on, you know, the main sort of points that were announced there? Sort of from a Sony angle of what was cool and what, why it's cool.
Yeah, look, I mean, I couldn't remember everything. It was an hour and a half worth of, you know, a whole lot of content. But like I said, Little Big Planet 3 was announced. The from a hardware point of view, the Glacier White PS4 will be a bundle for Destiny. We'll see that in New Zealand. PlayStation TV, we will see that in New Zealand later on in the year. What else? We saw some gameplay of the Order 1886, and like that looked really nice. It was good to see a new piece of gaming that I hadn't seen, and show a bit of the supernatural element, or the lichens that you'll be battling as well. There was a great range of third-party content as well, and they announced GTA 5 for next gen, and I'm really looking forward to giving that a hoon on my PS4, to be honest.
One of the big stars of your announcement, of course, was Sony managed to show the world the first shots of Mortal Kombat.
Yeah, that game looks insane. I got to see a bit more of that behind closed doors, and
sorry, mate.
It just looks like, you know, a movie that you're playing in, and the finishes, I guess, are something to behold. Really, they're not for the squeamish, that's for sure.
Yeah, well, they did say that it was only early days on what we saw with that one, eh?
Yeah, it's look, man, that looks like a whole lot of fun, and I'm keen to take that on for sure.
And you did mention, of course, Destiny is going to be coming bundled with the new PlayStation. Is Destiny everything it's hyped up to be, do you think?
Yeah, I think it is, man. I got a really quick session on it over there to play it. It looks fantastic, and it's a lot of fun. I think they've got, I mean, what they're trying to do is quite massive there, and something we haven't really seen before. But if you know, anyone can do it, it's Bungie, and it's going to be great that we're partnering alongside with Destiny, and there's more exclusive content to be announced for PlayStation 4 users as well.
You also mentioned the PlayStation TV, and that is definitely coming to New Zealand.
Yeah, we're looking to launch that later this year, so that'll be really exciting, really, just kind of an extender for your PS4 into the other room. And, you know, I think it's probably going to stop a lot of arguments. You know, you've got dad comes home and he wants to kick you off the PS4 because he wants to watch the news, while you've got a PlayStation TV in your room, and you can go off and carry on where you were playing on your PS4 in the lounge.
What sort of price point can we expect that to be in New Zealand?
Recommended retail is $159.95 for PSTV.
Yeah, that's fairly reasonable, considering that's would you consider that to be almost a game changer?
Yeah, I think it's really interesting proposition, really. I mean, it's a micro console there, so you can play your PlayStation Vita games on there. Not every game, because obviously your TV doesn't have a touch screen or a rear panel, but a quite big chunk of them. But you've got the PS1 classics on there, and minis and everything you can download from PlayStation Network. But I really think having that kind of extender, it's like, you know, just having another PS4 in the room, but which is a small little box. It's smaller than a box of cigarettes. It's quite a nifty piece of tech.
I think the other game changer that I noticed in the launch was the fact that you're going to be able to get PlayStation games through your Sony Smart TV as well.
Yeah, that's PS Now. That's sort of going into, well, it's just coming out of beta in the US. So it will be a very big game change of streaming of games. We'll have to see how long that takes to make it down our neck of woods, but we're definitely keeping a close eye on it and how it's been going in the US.
Has there been much interest, at least in the US, about, you know, going forward having these streaming games available?
I believe so. I don't have a lot to deal with the American team. We work out of London, but I think by all accounts, it seems to be a big push for them over there. And like you said, like a big game changer for how you would play games going forward.
You reckon there's going to be much re-educating of people about using streaming games? Because, I mean, it's not something that console gamers are used to.
Yeah, I think, I mean, we'll have to see what it's like. I haven't been able to, had a chance to try it myself, but I think, you know, as gamers go, they're pretty highly educated and they're really heavy sort of tech users. So I think it'll be pretty easy, pretty streamlined, if you pardon the pun.
And out of the third party announcements, what personally interested you?
Yeah, that's a tricky one too, because there's just such a lot of content coming out of E3. We talked about Destiny. I really enjoyed my brief hands-on with that. That looked really fun and looked really, really good. I really like the look of Far Cry 4, especially with the announcement that on PlayStation 4, you'll be able to invite friends in to play online co-op with you, even if your friends don't have the game of Far Cry 4. So that's another kind of a game changer, if you like, and a different way of sort of looking at the games. And then, look, I can't go past Batman Arkham Knight. That game looked amazing. Really dug that game, yeah, man. And I cannot wait to, like, stand up on top of a building and jump off and just fly around that city and just, you know, cause mayhem.
And what does the future hold for PlayStation in New Zealand?
Look, I think it's a really exciting time to be a gamer in New Zealand. We had a fantastic launch of PlayStation 4 at the end of last year, and the momentum's just really, really growing with a whole host of Kiwis getting their next generation fix on the PlayStation 4 platform. We can't forget about PlayStation Vita, which is, you know, keeps on bringing out some really fun on-the-go gaming experiences. And with the tech of remote play, but with a PS4 working with a PlayStation Vita, I think more and more people are going to start using that. The digital spectrum looks amazing. You would have seen some of the titles, a whole lot of titles that came out of the press event we had, but the indie titles are looking fantastic. The benefits that are coming to everybody who's a PlayStation Plus member looks amazing. And that content that came out of E3 looking towards, you know, 2014, 2015 and beyond, I really think we've only just sort of touched the surface of what's possible. And this year we're going to start seeing, you know, that the PlayStation 4 really is for the players. And it's just it's a great place to play and a really exciting time to be a gamer in New Zealand and the rest of the world, I think.
You just touched on it, but it was a question we also asked Xbox. Do you think that this year's E3, the real stars of E3 were the indie developers?
Yeah, look, I really like indie developers. I think that's where you get so much more experimentation and so much more variety. It's like an art house flick, you know, in the movie sense of things. It's really where those developers get to shine. You can come up with an idea that's just kooky and wacky, you know, like Octodad, an octopus that has to dress up as a father and get around town. Pardon?
It's crazy, that game.
Yeah, and like the control, if you've played it, the controlling mechanism using the DS4 puts my head into a spin, but once you get it, it's really cool. But, you know, there's no way that game back in the day would have ever made it to a disc because it wouldn't have had an investment. People were going, you know, what are you talking about? But now Octodad, people love it. People are getting behind it. And as it's going further and further, you know, the likes of Journey and some of those other games in the past, you know, Journey's been voted best game of console sort of thing. And that never would have been heard of as a digital title. So it's a really exciting place to see a lot of experimentation going on and just a whole variety of different experiences, I think, for the user. So, yeah, mate, I love indies and I'm really excited to see where they go this year.
I mean, you guys at the end of last year just launched the PlayStation 4. It's only really been, 6 and a half months since it was launched?
Yes.
It's been an amazing launch for you guys compared to your competitors. How does it feel to be working for the team that arguably has the battle in their hands at the moment? I tried to word that very carefully.
yeah, absolutely. Hey, look, it's great. I mean, I've always been PlayStation hard before I worked here as well, so it's great to be part of Team Blue, and it's exciting to see what the PlayStation 4 was and has become and was going to be in the future. Last year was a pretty hectic year for us, you know. It was a pretty busy time in that fortnight of next generation launches. But an exciting time for not just us, but the industry as well. So, you know, look, that battle's not won. We're not resting on our laurels. We need to carry on and keep on providing and coming through in our promises that we're here for the players. So we need to demonstrate that with experiences and the games that are coming out. But, you know, it's a good time to be on PlayStation platform. And, you know, we've always felt New Zealand's been a PlayStation nation. You hear that term thrown around a bit, but it's definitely showing itself more.
I'm actually still yet to jump into the next generation. Paul, why should I choose PlayStation?
Why should you choose PlayStation? Because we're here for the players. Basically, the PlayStation 4 was built from the ground up with the player in mind. It was built by developers, for players. So huge amounts of discussion went in of what developers needed out of a console. You know, in the past, consoles may have had rumors of being tricky to work on, whereas the PlayStation 4 has just totally surpassed that. So we're really seeing amazing experiences provided on there. It is the most powerful console on the market. You don't need to take my word for that. You can just look at it and see what sort of the resolutions our games are pumped out at. You know, it's a lot of fun. Mate, the controller, I think, is really a next-generation controller. We've looked at all the potential gripes from the DS3. They've refined all those and then added some really cool features like the light, the internal speaker, the touchpad, the clicker, all that kind of stuff. But it really is, if I reiterate my first point, it's for the players. So it's been built in mind for the gamer, and it's a lot of fun.
Okay, so that in mind, if I am convinced, will you send me one?
Yeah, we just have some trouble getting some couriers down to Hamilton somewhere. Like,
awesome. Thanks for taking the time for coming on Hashtag Radio.
No worries.
Hashtag Radio NZ. So, yeah, that was Krista. Apologise for the audio issues we had with that call.
Dirty old Skype wasn't playing nice.
No, it wasn't. But, yeah, PlayStation TV, I think, is actually going to be a bit of a game changer.
It sounds pretty good, and it's priced incredibly well. I was expecting it to be more.
Yeah.
But I guess they can't have it in the same sort of price as the console.
Yeah.
So definitely worth considering. If you haven't gone to the next-gen consoles yet, and you're umming and ahhing about which one to go for, they've definitely got some extra hardware features there. I mean, you're going to have to pay a bit more for those things.
Yeah.
But I think at the end of the day, make a lot of difference.
I tend to agree with him on the GTA 5 thing. I am very excited about GTA 5 on next gen.
Yes. Yeah. We've seen some comparisons with the GTA 5 footage from PS4 and PS3. And it just is such a huge improvement.
I didn't think you could improve it. I mean, that game looks beautiful on my 360.
Yeah. I've got a nice telly,
yeah,
and it looks really good on there.
Yeah.
But having watched these previews with the side-by-sides, oh my God.
Yeah, the detail's better. It's the slight styling things that they've done as well. Like,
yeah, just the textures and the grains, yeah, and stuff. And
the grass was a massive one.
Yeah, the grass. So there's a nice comparison with the deer on the hill.
Hmm.
And there's blades of grass. There's actual grass rather than just green patches.
Yeah.
And bushes and things.
The thing is, I thought that those green patches looked really cool.
So did I. I don't even want to go back to playing it now on the 360.
Bring on the next gen.
Next gen GTA 5. It looks like it's going to be exactly the same game.
Yeah.
But completely performance enhanced.
See, I might actually wait until next gen to actually finish the game, because I've barely played the story mode on that.
Yeah, same. I was totally into
online
with my dodgy cohorts.
Yeah.
having terribly good times.
Anyway, you're listening to Hashtag. We're brought to you by ATA, the Advanced Training Academy. You can check them out at ata.ac.nz. The PlayStation all day with Metal Gear Solid to Tekken 3 and from Omega Bells to Resident Evil. Just play for the fun, cause we got it going on.
get started. Resident Evil.
Hashtag Radio NZ.
You're back with Hashtag, and before the break, we spoke to Sony.
Yes. And it sounds like good times at Sony.
Yeah, they've had a good year.
I really am tempted to get a PS4.
Yeah, and you've been a staunch Xbox guy for the last few years.
That's right, but I'm even rocking a Sony phone now, so
yeah,
geez.
Insane. Well, yeah, well, you think about, what, 2 years ago? Coming up two years ago,
I had an iPhone.
Yeah, you had an iPhone, you're an Xbox guy.
And now I'm starting to...
You didn't have a radio show.
Didn't have a radio show.
Yeah.
Still hardly a radio show.
Yeah. But you've dropped the iPhone, you're on a Sony phone.
Yeah, I went...
Considering going Sony.
I went iPhone to Samsung.
Yeah.
To Sony.
Yeah.
So we're chasing S's around.
Yeah, see, and I went from being a staunch Android guy to BlackBerry, and now I'm on Windows.
Yes.
So I've gone just further backwards.
And you have a picture of an iPhone next to your bed.
Well, no. I've got an iMac now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You are iFid.
Anyway, back on track, E3. We'll have a chat to Steve from Xbox New Zealand. All right, so on the line we've got Steve from Xbox New Zealand. How are you going, Steve?
I'm good, a little bit jet lagged, but good.
So you've just flown back in the last week from E3.
Yep, got back to NZ Shores on Sunday, and kind of recovering from a bit of a cold, trying to get over the jet lag, but happy to be home.
Awesome. I think our first question that we have, being gaming fans ourselves, is E3 everything it looks like as a fan?
Yes, totally. I've been going for way too many years. I've been to quite a lot of E3s, and it's always, I mean, it ebbs and flows. It's had its ups and downs over the years, but it's always pretty spectacular. You have these, a couple of huge halls, think the size of, I don't know, kind of Eden Park, put two of those together, and then around it string a whole bunch of gaming fans and crazy LA scenery, and away you go. So yeah, it's always pretty spectacular. The stands are amazing. I mean, just epic scale. You don't really see anything like that in NZ, and it's always for a gaming fan. I mean, it's kind of like our gaming mecca. I mean, you kind of make that pilgrimage once a year, and as much as going in, we obviously know a lot of the news updates and the kind of releases and announcements that we'll be making. You know, for us, it's just a thrill as well to be able to get out on the floor and kind of walk the stands and kind of get to see some of the games. And you know, we're also in the lucky position that we get to obviously go behind closed doors and see some of the things that are being worked on. So for me, it's a long and very exhausting week, but it's also, it really kind of gets me excited and kind of gets me inspired for what's about to release in the gaming calendar this year.
So you guys went for a completely different sort of tack this year and focused 100% on games rather than hardware.
Yep, absolutely. I mean, I think we did get some announcements out on hardware just before E3, and that's where we announced, obviously, that we'd give the gamers some choice, kind of listening to the feedback, and took the Kinect sensor out of the Xbox One and had a price drop along with that, and an additional price drop in New Zealand, which was fantastic. So that was kind of interesting, just to get that out of the way before we went into E3, and then really, you know, I think kind of learning from previous years is just focus on the games and make that E3 briefing absolutely purely about games content. And I think, you know, most gamers would have watched all the briefings, and I think this year, you know, pretty much everyone I spoke to was kind of saying we had a very good briefing, very strong. I think very strong for this holiday as well. I think the guys, both from a first party and also a third party point of view, we've got some great games coming before Christmas on Xbox One. So we're all pretty excited.
Any personal favorites that are coming out soon?
Yeah, I mean, I could talk for hours on this. So, I mean, obviously, you know, the big three announcements from an Xbox and Microsoft first-party point of view is Sunset Overdrive, the Halo, the Master Chief Collection, and Forza Horizon 2. All three absolute, you know, killer games for various reasons. Sunset, just the queues for Sunset were kind of astonishing. And it's one of those things, I mean, obviously, Insomniac, huge developer, great kind of prestigious following. You know, prestigious developer with a huge following. You know, it's one of those games where you look at it, it's very fresh and it's very new, and you kind of hope it will land well. And look, if the queues at the show were are anything to go by, then that's definitely going to have a real kind of core gamer following. And I think, you know, you're just going to love it. And very different take on the shooter genre. The Halo stuff was a huge announcement, obviously, with Halo 1 and Halo 2 both completely remastered, and Halo 3 and Halo 4 ported, all to be released on Xbox One, all on one disc, 4,000 gamer score, over 100 maps, complete new storylines woven into bits of it, and also a digital series there, which is effectively leading up to Halo 5's release next year, and obviously beta access for the Halo 5 beta happening towards the back end of the year. So, I mean, huge value, 109 New Zealand dollars. I mean, it's just phenomenal, and I think that got a kind of a huge response from the fans there. I think some of the other titles that I saw that kind of really resonated, you know, if I think of standout favorites, it's interesting this show, there was a few new things, but, you know, I look at some things like Evolve. You know, Evolve was on the stand again. That just I went over to the 2K stand where they had a huge monster who just dwarfed everybody, but it was also on the Xbox stand. And that seems to, I mean, it's from the Left 4 Dead guys, yeah, I know there's a beta on Xbox coming out with us, which is really exciting. Can't wait to get onto that. And that seemed to get people going. Just watching the monster evolve and then four people are trying to take it down was pretty cool. The things that was interesting, though, was there's a lot of franchises this year. And so when I think of some of the big takeaways of, wow, those are games that I must play, it's definitely along the lines of Far Cry 4 and Assassin's Creed Unity. I think, you know, two games where Ubisoft are on fire this E3, just in terms of the quality and quantity of product that they're putting out. And those two in particular just stood out as being absolutely stunning, beautiful games. And I mean, I've played pretty, I think I finished actually pretty much every Far Cry. And for me to see Far Cry 4 selling the port, amazing opening to the Ubisoft press briefing, and then to go and be able to play it on the stand, it was, yeah, pretty stellar. I just cannot wait for that release. And then Assassin's Creed as well, four-player co-op, Paris, you know, where it's been set in Paris, back to that kind of old traditional Assassin's Creed, you know, where you kind of got to work for your kills, and then adding a co-op element into it. It was stunningly beautiful, and I just really, really wish it was releasing tomorrow. So those were two standouts. The indies as well had a good, you know, there was a good number of indies titles, both on the Xbox stand and the Sony stand, and a couple that stood out for me that I kind of picked up. One was Lovers in a Dangerous Space Time. Really quirky, unique title, and we kind of had it, you know, we jump from, you know, we're big gamers, and so we kind of try and get to play as much as we can whilst we're at the show. And we played that one through twice. So I mean, you know, considering how crunch for time, the fact that you know, the two Xbox guys kind of played that one through and then said, let's do it again, just kind of shows that that's going to be a heck of a lot of fun.
What sort of genre does that game fall
into? I don't know. It's a cooperative. There's two of you. You fly around in a kind of pink weird Death Star thing trying to save rabbits that have been imprisoned, and then eventually you unlock a big heart in the middle of space that you can jump through. There's no genre that really describes that as far as I can see. But it was pretty awesome, and it just, you know, it's very cutesy. The music's very addictive, and within seconds, Francois, who looks after Xbox software on my team, he and I were just both shouting abuse at each other. You should be on lasers. What are you doing driving the ship? And it was just like fantastic fun. So that's one to look out for. The other one that stood out, which is a completely different genre, is a kind of it's a film noir stroke ghost kind of game called White Knight, and it's again on the idea Xbox, the kind of the indie developer program.
I did see this one. It looked amazing.
Yeah, I'm really curious, and it just kind of, you know, you caught it out of the side of my eye, saw someone playing it, kind of walked over, thought, I've got to get into this, and so I had a go. And it's, you know, it's not amazing graphics, and yet the and it's very you know, that noir kind of crime detective fiction style stuff where you're walking around a house and you're basically doing it by matchlight, and you're looking for matches all the time and trying to work out these clues, avoid these kind of very weird ghosts that are in there, and it's kind of, you know, you touch them and that's it, you're dead, and it's kind of back to the start. So yeah, I mean, it, very gripping, very different to anything else that I really saw there, and kind of, again, you know, showing that the indies, you know, you don't need to have thousands of people spending 2 years to develop a game to just make something completely unique and compelling. So yeah, that was, it was pretty exciting to see that.
Would you go as far as to say that this E3 was very much the indies were almost the stars this year?
Oh, definitely. I think they're, you know, it's interesting. I mean, I haven't been to many E3s. They're definitely front and center now, which is really exciting to see. And I think it's also, again, you know, you tend to see that as consoles develop over their life cycle, and obviously the cost of kits and all that kind of stuff goes down. But I think it's interesting to see it so early on in this generation's release. I mean, we're less, you know, we're 6-7 months old, and you've already got hundreds of indie games represented on console at E3 and literally having people queuing up to play them. I mean, I think for gaming, it's quite interesting. Obviously, you're seeing these huge blockbuster releases, and of course, they kind of catch your imagination and kind of get people excited. And, you know, pre-orders are already kind of going off in New Zealand for some of those AAAs. But, you know, lovely to see that counterbalance with just real unique small studios, individuals who are just, you know, passionate gamers, want to get their idea out there and are kind of developing for it. So yeah, pretty exciting.
Before we move on, look, we've got a couple of questions we also want to ask about Xbox One in New Zealand, but I've got one last question about E3, and it's sort of our curveball here.
Yeah, okay.
What stood out for you from your competitors?
Again, I think the indies stuff was good, so I was quite impressed with that. There was nothing from the first party lineup that really wowed me that I saw at the show, and I think the order's a little way away, and they had a go on that. It looks amazing. I think that still were a little bit buggy, the stuff they had at E3, but it definitely kind of has got an immense amount of potential, so kind of looking forward to seeing more on that in the future. Destiny, again, they had Destiny pretty heavily on the stand. I also went up to Activision stand and played it you know, up there, and again, looks beautiful, you know, and kind of plays well, but again, it's on Xbox One, so that's not Sony specific as such. But yeah, I'd say the order's probably about the only standout thing for me where I was kind of intrigued and kind of want to see a bit more. It felt it was a little off in terms of the actual gameplay, you know, from what they had on their stand, but that's definitely from a look and the point of view, it looks pretty beautiful. Yeah, for me, it was the indies. I mean, they were kind of, there was so much of it, you know, and kind of mirrored our stand in a lot of ways in that regard. So that's the exciting stuff.
So we're getting some more software updates, which is fairly regular, but I mean, it doesn't worry me too much. I've got a reasonably fast internet connection, so it's
pretty much monthly at the moment. Yes.
And next month we're going to see the introduction of the Kinect voice commands in New Zealand.
Finally, and I know a lot of people, and me included, are very relieved about that. Yes.
Is that going to be the full features of the voice commands, or is it still going to be limited?
It's, so what it will be is, and it's been, you can imagine, it's been painful for us. I mean, we were the smallest country to launch, I get that, you know, on Xbox One, and kind of glad that we were in that kind of launch lineup. But it obviously brings its difficulties just in terms of the focus of that team in Redmond to kind of do that work, to kind of get things up to speed. So look, I think they've got voice modeling in there, which means that basically you can take any existing English voice model and be able to use it. We've already been doing it with US, Aussie and English voice models, and I know a lot of gamers in New Zealand have kind of switched dashes to be able to do that, so they have that voice functionality. I mean, it's as much as, you know, connects out of the Xbox now, it was built to kind of harness that to navigate with that. And I think if you haven't tried it, you know, don't underestimate how much that brings to the Xbox One's experience. So for me, I'm kind of absolutely delighted that finally we're there where it can be used in New Zealand. It
me
works
too.
Yeah, it works perfectly fine. I mean, I've been on, you know, I'm English. I've actually been on an Aussie voice model and a US voice model. Both of them worked completely fine. I haven't really had any problems using it, and just a lot of fun being able to do things like search, being able to snap stuff, being able to record stuff. So, you know, it's yeah, it, just it's been a long, hard road. And I know a lot of gamers on Xbox One have been frustrated it hasn't been there, and we're kind of happy that it's there. It will be very much the say what you see kind of approach. So, you know, it will be, you know, you'll say Xbox, the Kinect sensor will pick that up. It will show you all the things on screen that you can say. You can still do some voice searching, but it won't be conversational voice in the, hey, Xbox, today I fancy having a wander around here and see, you know, it won't be as sophisticated as that yet. But, you know, the Redmond team have committed that every single Xbox One market will get there in the future. And that's what they're kind of working to roll out. So, yeah, can't wait for that next iteration as well.
Fantastic. So that means that in New Zealand we won't have to switch our region anymore. We'll just be able to leave it as New Zealand.
And my job, I guess, over the next couple of months is really, you know, enticing those people back to, you know, who have switched and are kind of looking at a different dash and kind of get them back to kind of a Kiwi dash. I mean, for us, it's, you know, making sure that being able to use content and view the content that's kind of relevant to Kiwis. And we obviously do, you know, work with our teams to kind of get programming in there and kind of making sure that we're kind of highlighting Kiwi promos and all that kind of stuff. So, yeah, that's the focus for us over the next couple of months is starting to entice and kind of make noise to get people to switch back where they have moved away. And typically, you know, it can often be a frustrating process where you go to another dash, you can see content which, you know, maybe geofence for whatever reason when you're trying to actually consume it. So again, just getting people back onto the Kiwi dash so they get that end-to-end experience is definitely a key thing for us to look at.
What about with regards to the TV services? Is there anything in the pipelines in New Zealand as far as maybe with Sky TV or anyone?
We're talking to a bunch of partners. I mean, I think, you know, it's, again, one of the things that we struggle with, obviously, in New Zealand is scale. And, you know, you look at the markets like US, UK, and those and markets even as big as Australia, you know, they're kind of often on Xbox 360 timeline have warranted having some very bespoke development to get TV services through them. You know, the good news is over the last couple of years, we've seen, especially with, you know, the kind of the design of the Xbox One dash kind of looking a lot more like the Windows 8 dash now, we're able to actually get people across the line by A, it's reduced the cost to develop for Xbox considerably, and also when developers and often small developers are looking to outlay funding, they can actually kind of put that across different screens. So very different conversations, and yep, we're in conversations with a whole range of different partners in New Zealand at the moment. Nothing to announce today, but you know, those conversations are ongoing. I think the interesting thing that I'm excited about is if I look back through the last kind of, you know, several years on Xbox 360 in New Zealand, you know, it's often been hard when you get into those kind of, you know, those sheer conversations around scale and kind of ROI for engineers to kind of sit and program that service when you look at a small market like New Zealand. Now we're kind of deep in those conversations already, and we're, as I said, you know, we're 7 months, 8 months into a launch cycle. So pretty rapid kind of escalation for us. And again, I think, you know, when I look at the strategy that we've got from Redmond out to kind of look at really doing a fantastic gaming box, but looking at those additional entertainment services, exciting stuff for us. I mean, again, one of the things that we do is look at a lot of those stats of, you know, people on the Xbox Live service, what are they consuming? The interesting thing is, you know, games is absolutely up there, but so are a lot of the apps, and gamers are big you know, entertainment consumers. You know, there's very few gamers out there who do not like film, do not like TV, and do not like music, as well as a bunch of other entertainment and media apps. So, you know, we've kind of seen those patterns over the last several years with Xbox Live, and you know, I just want to get as much richness and as much goodness as I can for people to enjoy with their Xbox over the next couple of years in New Zealand.
Yeah, well, I'm still on the Xbox 360, and I know. But what I was going to say was, I've noticed even an increase in the last few months of apps and stuff coming over to that.
Yeah, look, one of the things I think is, you know, has been interesting is having gone from the original Xbox to Xbox 360, and the transition there was pretty short, to say the least. And I think, you know, we've definitely made some commitments as Microsoft and Xbox division of, you know, we're going to keep releasing updates, digital content especially, and also experimental, you know, titles where free-to-plays and all this kind of stuff into that community. You've got a huge volume of people out there still on Xbox 360 and enjoying that today. And yeah, continue kind of innovating, continue doing stuff there, because there's an immense amount of people still playing video games there and kind of having a great experience, and just, you know, looking forward to seeing them transition to Xbox One the fullness of time. But, you know, if you're enjoying it today, you know, there's, you know, no worries with sticking with it for a while longer.
Yeah, well, you got my address if you want to solve that problem.
I don't think I have, actually.
And I think probably our last thing is, we've been on sort of a personal mission on social media with trying to get your very own Major Nelson to try and get on our show.
Larry Herb, yeah, I know Larry quite well, yes. I sense there's an ask coming here.
Yeah, is there anything that Xbox New Zealand can do to help our cause to try and get him to come on our show?
We'll happily ask Major Nelson to see if he would be willing to get on the show. He's, as you can imagine, he's pretty, he's in demand. But I'm more than happy to put the ask in. I saw him last week, and it was, it's good. I mean, again, I've known Larry for, I don't know how many years now, 13, 14 years since my early days on the business. And he's a great bloke. And it's funny, you know, one of the other things was, you know, being a kind of old hand, as it were, going around the E3, seeing how many people are there now with, you know, the old kind of dash of silver in the hair. so it does feel sometimes like, gosh, you know, we've kind of aged dramatically in the last dozen years or so. But so Larry was there, and he was in fine form. I saw him just before he did the green carpet piece for the Xbox briefing. And look, I know he's done some stuff. He did some stuff for Halo 4 release here, where he did some specific shout outs for the Midnight audience. He also did some stuff at launch as well on the video pieces for that, and he's always, you know, he's always slammed, but he always tries to fit people in. So I will be delighted to ask him straight after this call.
Awesome. Anything you wanted to close with, Matt?
No, I think we're pretty good there.
Stuff.
Really appreciate you coming on the show, Steve, and we look forward to having a chat with you in the future, and maybe getting you back for Hashtag TV sometime.
Would love to do it. And look, you know, let's definitely think, as we kind of go into that September time period, when the game content, we go from just looking at trailers to actually having code and getting some stuff for you guys to have hands on. Would love to make sure you're kind of getting exposed to that.
Awesome.
Cheers.
You've done incredibly well, considering you're jet lagged as well.
I'm going to go lie down for quite a while in a moment.
Awesome. Thanks for that.
Sweet. You're welcome.
Hashtag Radio NZ.
You're back with Hashtag. Awesome to hear from both sides of the war.
Well, yes and no. It's not really a war here in New Zealand, is it?
Do we want to get into that?
Not really.
No, I mean, there's definitely a battle going on between two of the bigger companies. The third one's sort of there.
And this pretty much brings us to the close.
Yeah, it is the end of our show this week.
But before we go, we'd just like to put it out there that next week is our second birthday.
It is our second birthday. We've been doing this for 2 whole years.
2 years of Hashtag Radio, and we'd like to thank everyone.
Yeah.
It's been a bit of an awesome ride. We're going to hopefully have some giveaways and bits and pieces over the next few weeks.
We're working on it. We're going to do it a bit differently this year, so make sure you tune in to our birthday show, second birthday show, next week to hear all about it. By now you should have subscribed on iTunes to the Hashtag Me Podcast Network, because, as well as being able to listen to our beautiful voices every week through there.
Oh yeah.
We've of course got access granted with Raj and Mike.
And those guys are going from strength to strength.
Yeah, every show from them is just getting better and better. I'm loving it. They've had some awesome guests too.
Absolutely. I'm cracking into that.
But we also have just launched a third podcast.
A third podcast.
Yeah. Well, of course, it's got the sexy, sultry voice of Phid McAwesome on this new show. We're talking about Bits of Awesome.
Bits of Awesome.
Yeah. It's going to be a fortnightly show.
and it's all about retro video games.
Retro gaming podcast.
Yeah, so I don't have to talk about retro games on this show anymore.
Thank goodness.
So if you're into retro gaming, make sure you check that out. And yeah, subscribe anyway. Tell your mates all about all of our shows and how awesome we are.
And if you despise retro gaming, have a listen anyway and then troll them.
While you're talking about trolling, why don't you troll us on Facebook and on Twitter?
Yeah, get along there. We're
Hashtag Radio NZ on Twitter and on Facebook. Yeah. So anyway, follow us on Twitter. Follow us on, or like us on Facebook. We're on Instagram as well, hashtag MeCoNZ.
Yeah, we need to get a bit more Instagram going.
Yeah. Anyway, that's us for another week. Make sure you tune into our birthday show next week.
See you then. See you.
Hashtag Radio NZ.
Zone.